Good morning, West Side. Welcome to worship with the community of West Side Unitarian Universalist Church, where compassion leads us to work for justice and equality. My name is Diane Jones, and I am your worship leader this morning. I'm glad you're joining us for our service today, and it is my hope that this gathering will renew your sense of community and connection and nourish your heart, mind, and spirit. Thank you to our AV team volunteers today, Spencer Maxwell, and co-hosts Donald Kennard and Jonathan Sarmiento. And special thanks to our pianist, Yuki Kumamoto, for our gathering music and prelude this morning, as well as Director of Lifespan Religious Education, Nikki Kennedy, who is always helping us in every aspect, and her help with the execution of the Time for All Ages this morning. At Westside, we are raising the next generation of Unitarian Universalists, and we want them to know that they are an important part of our community. Several years ago, we chose to be radically inclusive and to adopt a multi-generational worship where our services include all family members. So welcome to all children and youth this morning. Westside is a community of many beliefs, genders, and sexualities, a community of diverse cultural, racial, class backgrounds, a community of varied abilities and gifts. Some here find inspiration in the great books, others in the great outdoors, and others still in great conversation. Whoever you may be, we welcome you to bring your whole self into this community. If you are so moved, you can try out the chat feature on Zoom by typing in some words of welcome to both members and visitors who are joining us this morning. On behalf of this church community, I say to all, welcome. Our reflection this morning is delivered by our interim minister, Frieda Gillespie, and her wife, Jen Long. It is entitled Unexpected Gifts, and this will be Reverend Frieda's last reflection for Westside. Now, I invite you to take a deep breath. And from wherever you are, settle into this sacred space that we created together. Now let us worship together as we listen to this morning's prelude.
Opening words today, I'm going to share just a few UU jokes and stories. The following true story was handed down from author Frances Moore Lapp's parents. When Frances was a child, she went with a friend to Bible class. Later that day, her mother asked, "What had she done all day?" And she replied by asking, "What's hellfire and damnation?" Her father heard Frances ask the question and said, "It means it's time to gather a Unitarian fellowship." Her parents then founded such a fellowship in Fort Worth, Texas, where this story is still told. Thoreau was questioned about his beliefs during the last hours of his life. A concerned neighbor at his bedside asked, "Have you made peace with your maker?" Thoreau answered, "I have never quarreled with my maker." The questioner continued, "Are you concerned about the hereafter?" To which Thoreau replied, "One world at a time." It has been my observation that when there is only one Unitarian Universalist church in a town, sooner or later, everyone I don't like comes to that church and forces me to reflect on their inherent worth and dignity. The fundamentalist Christian said to a UU, "I hear you deny the divinity of Christ." The UU responded, "No, that's not true. We don't deny the divinity of anybody." The difference between Universalists and Unitarians is that Universalists believe that God is too good to damn men, and Unitarians believe that man is too good to be damned. "Wake up, honey," she said. "It's time to get up and get dressed for church." "I don't want to go to church," he said. "I don't think the people like me, and I don't like them. Give me two reasons why I should go to church." "Well, for one, it's good for you," she said. "And second, you're the minister." These jokes and stories are from a little book called The Church Where People Laugh.
Well, those made me laugh, that's for sure. Our opening hymn this morning is "Go the Distance," performed by Ben Long.
Of a far off place where a hero's welcome would be waiting for me, where the crowds will cheer when they see my face, and the voice keeps saying, "This is where I'm meant to be. I'll be there someday. Strong on a wavering mind.
My name is Walker Maxwell. This is my sister Finley and my mom Leanne. I'm a youth here at Westside UU Church. Please join me by lighting your chalice at home if you have one.
The Flaming Chalice is our worldwide Unitarian Universalist symbol of both the heritage of our past and the light of hope within this congregation today.
Our chalice lighting words this morning are by the Reverend Suzelle Lynch. Each time we light the chalice, we renew our commitment to our Unitarian Universalist faith. With a spark of the match, we make it new again, as fresh and surprising as the first day. As the first day we encountered the spiritual community and realized we were home.
Our chalice lighting song is Be the Light by Leah Morris.
There is always a light when we are ready to see it. There is always a light when we are ready to be it. To see the light, to be the light, to raise our eyes in the dark of night, to climb this hill, together we will. There is always your a light in the dark. When we are ready to see it. There is always your light in the dark. We are ready to be it. To see the light, let to your be light, heart to raise our eyes in the dark of night and be a gift. Together we will. There is always there is light. Your light. There is always in the dark. We are ready to see it. There is always there is always light. Your light. There is always in the dark. We are ready to be it. To see the light, to be the light, to shine our eyes in the dark of night, and be a kindness is here. Together we will. There is always light, there is always dark. Shine our eyes, there is always dark. To see the light, to be the light, to shine our eyes in the dark of night, and be a kindness.
Please join me in reciting our affirmation. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest of truth is its sacrament and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve others in community, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with creation. Thus do we covenant with one another. Our time for all ages today will be the 7 UU Principles Suite, presented by Chris Ussery from the Community Church of Park Forest.
At the gatherings of the people, people in this place, burns the chalice flame, creating sacred space, celebrating every being's inherent worth, every creature large and small upon the earth, every creature large and small, every creature large and small, every creature of the earth from the moment of its birth, every creature of the earth. At the gatherings of the people in this place, we affirm these rights for all the human race. Justice, equity, compassion shown to all, every person where they stand and where they fall, every person where they stand, every person where they fall, every person of the earth from the moment of their birth, every person of the earth. At the gatherings of the people in this place, every search for spirit shall be given grace. We encourage every individual's quest. Every spirit knows what's right and knows what's best. Every spirit knows what's right. Every spirit knows what's best. Every spirit of the earth from the moment of its birth, every spirit of the earth. Free and responsible,
That was a terrific selection from our Director of Lifespan Religious Education. Thank you, Nikki Kennedy, so much. Love that. Our joys and concerns this morning will be shared by Kelly Flanagan, a representative of the Pastoral Care Team.
Good morning, everybody, and happy spring. As we share our joys with others, those joys are multiplied. When other hearts know our joy shines all the brighter. As we share our concerns, our community can offer its care. When other hearts know our sorrow, our burden becomes lighter. This is the time in our service when we offer witness and support for one another's journeys. Please post in the chat if you have a joy or concern you would like to share with everyone today and with those who will be watching the recording later. Joys and concerns can be submitted at any time via email to pastoralcare@westsideuu.org or through the web form, which is located on the care and support page of the church's website. This week's joys and concerns include: we have a joy from Carol Kappa and Sue Spell. We had a wonderful time seeing the sights in Seattle this week and bring Westside greetings and love from Seattle and Fort Worth members Amy Youngblood and Mike West. We have a joy from Benjamin Long. It was an honor to be able to perform for this service. This was also my very first time in the state of Texas. I will never forget it. A joy from Cindy Fountain. Yes, celebrating spring. Yesterday was a perfect start. We have a concern from Sharon Sela. I'm sad to report that Gary's feline buddy, Singer, went out for his morning constitutional a few days ago and never returned. A joy from Maddie Sellers. We went camping for spring break, hooray! A joy from Stephanie Jeffers. It's a joy to be joining from Arizona with my friend Renee. And a concern from Leanne Maxwell. In light of the hate crimes against Asian women in the Atlanta area, please keep the Asian American Pacific Islander community in your thoughts and actions moving forward. Thank you for sharing those with us. It is good to share with one another as sharing draws our community closer together. Please know that our pastoral care associates are available to support you with deep listening and, when needed, through our InReach Fund for short-term financial support of members in need. We are here for you.
Thank you, Kelly. This morning's centering song is There Is a Love, performed by members of the Melrose UU Church.
Thank you. I invite you to join me in a time of centering. Each week here at Westside, we open our hearts to those in our community who know both joys and challenges, and to those who may be suffering in the wider world. I will begin with a poem today before we move into a time for silent reflection. I will ring a bell to signal the start of the time for your own meditation, prayer, or reflection, and I will ring the bell again at the end. I invite you and your families to sit comfortably with your feet grounded and your spine tall. Perhaps close your eyes as I begin with this meditation by Reverend Karen Johnston. We will get through, not unscathed to be sure. Too much has already been lost. Too many beloveds have been lost. So not unscathed, but a new kind of whole. The kind that only emerges from the going through it, from the wrestling with it, from the demanding something in exchange for what we lose. Making clear what we claim, making clear what we demand in return is not personal gain or revenge, but a blessing. Shaped by our loves and our losses, our sorrows and our joys, our failures and our triumphs, a blessing. Shaped by our bodies and minds, by our singing and dancing, by our praying and listening, by the beauty we persist in co-creating, the justice we insist upon. A blessing shaped by our dedication to the values that shape us. Unremitting compassion, a joyful and radical inclusion, a preferential option for the poor and marginalized, a deep and wide dismantling of white supremacy, honoring the great mystery of life with appreciation and humility, and with a commitment to collective liberation that frees all. A blessing for all. May it be so, blessed be, and amen. Keep muting me.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Christina Sellers, the Social Justice Committee's representative this morning. West Side Service Project for this month is Meals on Wheels of Tarrant County. Meals on Wheels' mission is to promote the dignity and independence of older adults, persons with disabilities, and other homebound persons by delivering nutritious meals and providing or coordinating needed services. Meals on Wheels began in 1973 as a collaboration between 11 faith-based organizations in downtown Fort Worth to bring food to the elderly in the central city area. Today, it serves all of Tarrant County, providing approximately 1 million meals each year. Westside member John Fisher is a Meals on Wheels recipient. John has a tricycle for transportation. John has graciously shared some thoughts. The big disadvantage to the tricycle is inclement weather. In the past freeze, Texas was hit with record-shattering cold and power outages. I miss shopping because of the extended frigid weather, but for a couple of years now, I have been a Meals on Wheels recipient. I have always found the food to be nourishing, warm, and delicious. Meals on Wheels has been an invaluable supplement to what I can fit into the sizable but finite basket between the trike's rear wheels. And Meals on Wheels volunteers are as unfailing as U.S. mail service when my father was a letter carrier. But the unprecedented cold and snow closed down even Meals on Wheels for 3 days. Then on Thursday, through the snow-covered streets came a young Meals on Wheels driver bearing 3 non-perishable meals for me. I was going to make it. It was such a joy to see them, and joy is not a word I use promiscuously. Meals on Wheels does life-saving work, and I need to say a big thank you. Let's join John in thanking Meals on Wheels by contributing to this worthy organization. You can give online either through the church's giving page or by using the Give Plus app. Just select the Service Project Fund. You can also mail a check to the church. Thank you for your offering. Get your tissues ready and enjoy this musical offering from Ben Long.
Looking back on the memory of the dance we shared beneath the stars above. For a moment, all the world was wrapped. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? All would go.
That was great. I loved hearing that song. Thank you, Ben Long, again, for sharing your talent with us this morning. I'd also like to thank Westside for our generosity with Meals on Wheels this month, and thank John Fisher for sharing his testimony. He's such a good articulator of his thoughts and feelings. And now let us enjoy the joint reflection from Reverend Frieda and her wife, Jen Long.
My portion of this memoir is called Return to Myself. I've been so grateful that Jennifer decided to come to Fort Worth with me and that we were bringing one of our and most sweet cats and our little dog, Lil, with us as well. With COVID still raging, it seemed to me that we were in for a lonely time. As an interim minister, so much of my work is directly with the congregation, and I was at a loss as to how I was going to make that happen with only Zoom contact. But as we got our little house in order, thanks in large part to those of you who helped us, who brought furniture and arranged the furniture so nicely, I started to realize that something was wrong with me. I was experiencing a lot of confusion and lethargy, which did not used to be the way I was with my work or in my life, for that matter. It was easy to attribute this to the changes we are all experiencing. I started to secretly wonder, though, if I was experiencing early onset dementia. It was very frightening, and I worried most about Jennifer and what that would do to her in our relationship. She had seen me through a long bout of cancer treatment 7 years ago, and it took quite a toll on her. I don't know how I would do this interim ministry. This all got dramatically worse around the holidays. My legs were acting oddly as well, which made no sense because I've been strong physically, at least enough to go on long hikes. Then it was hard to navigate the steps leading up to our house. I couldn't make sense of the changes in myself. Jennifer rightly perceived that I was having neurological problems, and we sought out a referral to a neurologist at DFW Neurology. Any one of my symptoms could be attributed to aging or depression. I wanted to put in a plug for this medical group because they were wonderful, really more than wonderful, because one of their newer doctors ordered an MRI and began to see the problem. I was referred to Fort Worth Brain and Spine Institute, where Dr. Alford reviewed my MRI and suggested a test to see if I had NPH. Normal pressure hydrocephalus. This condition is caused by an excess of fluid in the brain creating pressure. It causes exactly the three problems I had: dementia, poor balance and gait, and incontinence. The doctors say wacky, wobbly, and wet. Of course, any of these can be the result of aging and are often missed in older adults. My diagnosis was missed by the doctors in Boston, partially because I had neuropathy that resulted from chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is the gift that keeps on giving, causing symptoms, some of them permanent, years after treatments. In a way, the Boston doctors knew too much about my history. Dr. Alford from the Brain and Spine Institute suggested a surgery to put a shunt into my brain that drains into my abdomen. This is what they did. After a couple of days to recover from the surgery, I began to see the benefits of this. Now, 2 months after, I feel like my brain has been fully recovered and my legs' agility has returned. I was able to give up medication for incontinence. I've been returned to myself. Every day I've risen to thank the Fort Worth doctors for how the new sense of balance and strength energy and enthusiasm, creativity, the ability to concentrate and write and relate to others has been restored to me. It seems nothing less than a miracle, and indeed, that seems to be the result most people experience from this particular surgery. That's probably more than you want to know. Suffice to say that when anyone asks how I feel, the answer is great.
Well, my reflection is called A Grand Adventure. Frieda has been an interim minister for quite a few years and has served churches in North Carolina, Georgia, Nebraska, and Maine, as well as Massachusetts. Until this time, she's always done the traveling, usually 3 weeks and three weekends away, and then one weekend at home, or 10 days. This was necessary because we had school-aged kids at home until recently, and because my job was and is in Boston. We decided, though, that this time, if she ended up out of town, I would go with her and telecommute. The kids are old enough, they're in school, and my company was okay with the idea, even pre-COVID. It would be a grand adventure, we thought, a chance to experience another part of the country. We were excited for the opportunity, and Frieda considered positions in a number of different cities across the country. When Frieda told me that we were going to Texas, I was a little less excited. I went to undergrad at Rice, and while I loved the school and I had a great experience there, Houston was not my favorite place. And I'd been to Dallas quite a few times for work. It wasn't up there on my list either. All that said, I had never been to Fort Worth. And I have friends in Texas. My college roommate is in Austin. We have a close friend in Frisco. And I knew Stan was out here, although I didn't know he was a member of the church until very close to the time we moved here. That was a fun surprise, as we were classmates at Rice a million years ago. So I decided and set my mind to having a grand adventure. I was determined to find things I liked about Fort Worth and to focus on those. And so we set out. We rented a house off the internet, sight unseen, based on proximity to the church, assuming we'd be meeting in person soon. Stan did a drive-by to check out the neighborhood, and so many of you donated furniture and kitchen things. That worked out great. We shipped off a few of our things, put our car on a truck to be transported here, and flew out with our elderly dog and cat in tow. My plan was to go home every 4 to 6 weeks to check in on Ben, who was taking care of the house in Massachusetts, and to show my face at the office. But that didn't end up happening due to COVID. I don't think any of us expected to be in lockdown for quite this long. So as soon as we arrived, as planned, I started making my list of things I liked about Fort Worth. I tried to add to it almost every day. I kept a little piece of paper in my planner and I would write things down for the first few weeks. And since the first few weeks, I've been adding to it sporadically. I'd like to share that list with you. It covers a lot of ground, and I think there are things about your city that you may not appreciate that I'd love to call your attention to. So it's a bit of a random list. The first is the wonderful warm welcome we received from all the folks at Westside. I don't think we've ever had a parade in our honor, and that was a lot of fun, even though it was really hot. But it was a lot of fun. Our little house, it's the perfect size for us, and I'm loving this minimalist lifestyle that we have here, where it's 800 square feet and only the things we need. I love that. We have a great neighborhood and we have sweet neighbors and we've met them and their dogs and I love that as well. There are three great restaurants we can walk to and we quickly got to know the managers and owners. There's Enchilada Ole, Tommy's Catfish Place, and Cafe Four, which is owned by four Pakistani sisters, and it's been really fun to have that local sense of restaurants. You guys, there's free parking everywhere in Fort Worth. That is awesome. The Kimball Museum. We love the Kimball, and there's free parking there, right there in front of the museum. I couldn't believe it. You can buy wine at Target. You cannot do that in Massachusetts. You can buy wine at the grocery store here. You can buy wine everywhere here. It's awesome. You guys have turning lanes in the middle of these streets. We don't have turning lanes. I love the turning lanes. Your streets are marked. You've got street signs. That's also really cool. We love Trinity Park and trails. We've been walking there almost every morning. Bluebell ice cream is on my list. I had forgotten about Bluebell. Barbecue. We don't have great barbecue in Massachusetts, and I'm ashamed to admit that I discovered I really like brisket. The TCU campus is gorgeous. Lots of diversity in the city. When we go out walking at the Trinity Park, we see all sorts of families, all sorts of people. I love that. There's a great Thai restaurant really near us called Spice. If you haven't checked it out, you should. You can get margaritas to go. here. That's like so cool. You don't know. The sky in Texas. Everyone talks about the sky in Texas, and I never really appreciated it in Houston, but it's a thing. It's beautiful. The Modern Art Museum and the Amon Carter Museum are terrific. The Stockyards, super fun. Major touristy thing, super fun. The Fort Worth Nature Center out in Lake Worth, just a beautiful place to go. Fresh figs in the grocery store. We never see that at home. We have a bamboo grove in our backyard. Again, love that. Central Market. Okay, I know it's a little bougie, but I kind of love it. Paddleboarding right downtown. You can go paddleboarding on the Trinity River right in the middle of downtown. Super cool. Generally speaking, the produce is great. We have wonderful sunsets right from our front stoop. We're west facing and we have these glorious sunsets. Hearing the Fort Worth Symphony was amazing. Even seeing them behind their individual, the wind players at their individual plexiglass little cubes in a socially distanced concert hall. That was a highlight. We can hear TCU football games in season from our front yard. That's kind of fun. I developed an appreciation for the quality of medical care in Fort Worth and how easy it is to access. Unfortunately, had to develop that. Our backyard feral cats, Smudge, Buffy, and Marshmallow, really have gotten fond of them. We've trapped them and had them neutered and vaccinated, and they still come for breakfast and dinner every day. Panther City Feral Cat Coalition, where I've been volunteering, really wonderful people. My sweet foster kittens, all seven of them that we've been bottle feeding for the past few weeks. Feeding giraffes at the zoo was a lot of fun, and the meerkat exhibit is wonderful, and the underwater view of the hippos. The fact that spring actually starts in March here. So I know that's a random list, and that's just a few things. And there's more, even more to love, I'm sure, about Fort Worth and about Westside. We haven't gotten to the Botanic Garden yet. I'm guessing that would get added to my list. And I'd hope to be here and get to know all of you in person, since I've truly enjoyed the services and coffee hours and getting to know some of you at least a little bit in various virtual meetings and venues. I'd hope to see the new garden in bloom and to play some more flute duets with Carol. And while I'm sorry we won't be here longer, I have found a lot to love about Fort Worth and Westside in a relatively short time. So perhaps this was not the grand adventure we had imagined, but we've certainly had quite an adventure in our short time here. We squeezed in a lot of wonderful experiences, along with a major illness and brain surgery, and then the joy of a full recovery and the sadness of leaving earlier than planned. None of us can predict what will happen when we set out on a new path. The experience is the adventure, and I'm glad to have shared this adventure with you all. I wish you all the very best as you navigate the end of this pandemic time, your return to in-person church, and whatever is next for you. And I hope you all appreciate Westside and Fort Worth as much as I have. Thank you for being part of my grand adventure this year.
One of the reasons I wanted to work in Texas was that it's always been a place of transformation for me. I went to seminary here and found my calling as a minister. Adopted my daughter Talisha here. I also met a Jungian analyst with whom I did therapy for 2 years here. And now this neurosurgery. Who knows what would happen if I were to stay longer? Alas, that is not to be. Your leadership decided that they didn't think you all were in a place to do transition work, given the stress of being in this shutdown mode for so long. I totally understand that. That, coupled with a lack of confidence in me, based on how I was when I came here, made them decide not to continue with me as their minister. We are sad about that, but understand their decision. I'm often asked to give some observations of the congregation I serve, and I have a few for you. The first is your awareness and efforts at hospitality. Everyone has trouble putting themselves in another's shoes, especially a stranger. I think you did very well with the welcome that we received. You went the extra mile by arranging a cozy home for us. The drive-by welcome was so fun and sweet. And I so appreciated the cards of welcome and the get well cards that text you sent during my illness. I've observed how well you stay in touch with everyone and care about each other. I love your clear intention and efforts to create a multi-generational church. I also appreciate your social justice awareness and the efforts you make to educate yourselves, for example, in anti-racism and gender issues. Unlike many small congregations, you aren't obsessed and worried about money. Some congregations evaluate newcomers solely or largely on what size pledges they think they'll give them. You have so many smart and talented people at Westside, which allows you to create great worship services. Thank you for welcoming our son Ben Long to sing. The next time you hire or call a minister, think on how to bring them into the workings of the congregation right away. A calendar of regular services and events, Zoom links for everything, assuming they're still in that mode. Don't assume they know anything at all about your church. Share with them the ways in which you see yourself and what you hope for. Who are the decision makers outside of the org chart? What events in your history affect you now? The more you can share, the better your minister will be able to serve you. I feel confident that you will be able to continue to build this congregation. I am grateful for my time with you and wish you nothing less than that you thrive in the years ahead. May it be so.
All right. Thank you very much. And our closing hymn this morning is Let It Be, performed by Ben Long.
Our closing words are from the poet Robert Browning. Oh, what a gift, the gifty Gius, to see ourselves as others see us. It would from many a blunder free us and foolish notion.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye, Westside.
We love you.
And now join me in the congregational closing as we extinguish our chalices together. Let us go in peace, believe in peace, and create peace in our lives and in the world. Let it be.